জয়িতা দিয়ে স্টার্ট করার আগে একবার দেখে নেবে শেয়ারিংটা কাজ করছে কিনা ঠিকঠাক।
হ্যাঁ 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 দেখে না। হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ দেখা যাচ্ছে গো।
দেখা যাচ্ছে তো? আচ্ছা ঠিক
হ্যাঁ
আছে,
হ্যাঁ
ওকে।
আচ্ছা, আমরা কি একটুখানি 2-3 মিনিট ওয়েট করবো? অনেক স্টুডেন্টের 3টে পর্যন্ত ক্লাস ছিল, ওরা জয়েন করছে এক এক করে।
আমার কোনো অসুবিধা নেই।
ঠিক আছে, জাস্ট 2-3 মিনিটস। I request our IQSC coordinator, Dr. Samrat Bhattacharya, to inaugurate our program.
Thank you, Joita. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So I would like to formally welcome all of you, all the students, the faculty members to this webinar on Going Beyond Equilibrium, Physics of Active Particles, which is organized by Department of Physics in collaboration with the Internal Quality Assurance Cell. On behalf of Principal Sir, Principal Ma'am and Vice Principal Sir, I would like to welcome all of you. They are actually engaged in some important work in government office, so they could not attend. They have extended their greetings to Physics Department. Physics is one of the stellar departments in our college and has been organizing very informative, very effective webinars and seminars throughout the year. And this is, of course, one of them. I am thankful to the department that the department is collaborating with the Internal Quality Assurance Cell. Ever since I have taken charge of IQAC, I have worked with Dr. Upendranath Mundi also, the former head of the department. And many of the webinars were conducted along with IQAC. So I am thankful to the department for collaborating with them. And especially, I am thankful to Dr. Urna Basu, today's resource person, who is also one of our former students of Physics Department. We have plentiful of such eminent alumni in our college who are coming back and taking classes, giving lectures, conducting webinars in order to encourage and uplift the students also. I would thank Dr. Urna Basu, who has agreed to be a resource person in this webinar. And I would expect that the collaboration that she has extended with us will also increase in the days to come in other various areas from where students as well as the department holistically and the college will get benefit. I would welcome you once again all on behalf of the college. And I would thank the physics department for inviting me and wish all success for this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Samrata. Now I request Dr. Upendranath Nandi to say a few words about Urna.
You can see me. Respected Principal, respected Vice Principal, sir, and my dear brother, IQAC coordinator, Dr. Samrat Bhattacharya. And I am really indebted to our head of the department, Dr. Joita Chowdhury, for giving me this opportunity to introduce the speaker in this webinar. So today's speaker, Dr. Urna Basu, we are proud to say that she is our ex-student. Dr. Basu did her graduation in 2000 from this college, the Scottish Church College, under the University of Calcutta. Dr. Basu masters from the University of Calcutta in 2007 with specialization in quantum field theory, particle physics. After that, she did her post-MSc from Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics and did her dissertation there during the post-MSc course with Professor P.K. Mahanty. Another, that time, I think I also met Professor Mahanty, very energetic, young, and brilliant guide, brilliant guide. And from the same institute, Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics, under Professor P.K. Mahanty, Dr. Basu did her PhD. The title of her PhD topic was Absorbing State Phase Transitions in Presence of Conjugate Fields. In 2013. After that, Dr. Basu did several postdocs. She did her first postdoc in Belgium from 2013 to 2015, worked with Professor Dr. Christian Meis. After that, she did her second postdoc in Italy from 2015 to 2017, working with Professor Dr. Andrea Gambassi. And the last postdoc, the third one, she did in France from 2017 to 2018, working with Professor Dr. Gregory Serre. At present, Dr. Basu is the assistant professor at Satyendranath Bose National Center for Basic Sciences, Calcutta. So today, Dr. Basu will be talking on the going beyond equilibrium physics of active particles. Dr. Basu, please.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for the kind introduction. It's a great pleasure to speak at the college where I have studied for 5 years, and I'm really grateful for the opportunity. So shall I start sharing screen?
Yes, yes. Yes, please.
Okay. Yeah, I'll also turn off my video. I'll turn it on later when there are questions, etc. Just in case there is some connection problem. Yeah. So I'm going to talk about going beyond equilibrium. So my research area is non-equilibrium classical physics, and I am going to talk about a particular topic from there, the physics of active particles. So this is the outline of this talk. I'll start with a brief, very, very brief overview of equilibrium statements, which most of you probably know. So are there students from first year also?
Yes, yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. So, I just wanted to tell you that in case any of the words or anything is not clear, please stop me. I have tried to make it as less technical as possible. I have not gone into any mathematical details or anything. It's more of an overview talk. But if anything is not clear, if any term is not clear, just stop me. Stop me and ask me. And that way, I think it will be better for both. And you can also ask in the chat. Okay. Yeah, so I'll start with a very brief overview of equilibrium statement, and then I'll talk about what happens when we go beyond equilibrium in the non-equilibrium regime. And then I'll introduce this particular branch of non-equilibrium systems, the so-called active particles, and how they behave, how they are very different from equilibrium systems. And then I'll talk about two particular models of active particles, the so-called active Brownian particle and Raman-Tumble particles, and then I'll just summarize. So equilibrium. So all of you are familiar with the concept of equilibrium, concept of thermodynamic equilibrium. It refers to the situation when internal state of one system or the system is in equilibrium with its surroundings when certain conditions are met. In particular, when there is a thermal equilibrium, so there is no net heat flow from the system to its surroundings or the other way. There's mechanical equilibrium, so there is no net mechanical force on any part of the system. There's chemical equilibrium, and along with that, there's also no net exchange of matter between the system and its surroundings. So if these conditions are satisfied, we say that the system is in thermodynamic equilibrium. Another thing comes with it, that's the so-called stationarity condition. So if a system is in equilibrium, no macroscopic property of the system changes over time. So this is a necessary condition for equilibrium, but it's not sufficient. Okay, this is just a side remark, we'll use it later. So because the macroscopic properties are not changing with time, so it happens to be possible to describe the system with a few macroscopic variables. So this is the job of thermodynamics. It's a macroscopic approach. And the state of a system is characterized by macroscopic variables like pressure, volume, or temperature. Okay, and as all of you know, there's something called equation of state, which is a relation connecting these variables, connecting these macroscopic variables. So the simplest example is an ideal gas, which is a collection of non-interacting particles. And the equation of state there is PV equal to nRT, as you all know. And then there are certain empirical laws which govern thermodynamic processes, the so-called laws of thermodynamics. However, no information about microscopic dynamics of these constituents of a system can be gained from thermodynamics. So this is where statistical mechanics comes into play. The purpose of statistical mechanics is to understand these microscopic behaviors from a microscopic picture. As a first step, probably all of you have studied kinetic theory of ideal gases. So this is a first step towards statmic, where we try to understand the behavior of constituent particles, and try to see how certain thermodynamic relations can be derived. Okay. So the question that one asks first is, how does an individual particle behave? So here, can you see my cursor?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. So suppose we ask the question that how does this individual particle behave in a collection of particles? The answer is it's random. We can't say anything about it definitively. Okay. Even though all the particles are completely classical, I mean, at least we are considering classical particles. In the classical regime, they are evolving via Newton's equations. But because of sheer number, and if there is some small error, then the error multiplies, and it's not possible to say anything definitively about the motion of one single particle. So that's where probability comes in, statistics comes in. So probabilistic approach is needed. And this is what we do in statistics. Okay, so there are some very famous results of equilibrium statistical mechanics. So one talks about probability distribution of velocity, energy, or position of individual particles or part of the system or the system as a whole. So I'll just mention two such famous results, which again all of you know. The first one is the velocity fluctuation. It's governed by something called Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution for ideal gas particles at temperature T. So this distribution gives the number of particles which have a velocity, magnitude of velocity near a certain range, V and V plus delta. Okay. Then there is another result which dictates the fluctuation of energy. So we are thinking of a canonical ensemble. The system is in contact with some thermal bath at temperature T. And we are asking, what is the probability that the energy of the system is E? Okay. And this is given by this very general distribution, the so-called Gibbs-Boltzmann distribution, and it says that the probability is proportional to exponential minus beta e. So the higher the energy, the system is less likely to be at this energy. So this is some sort of an universal result, irrespective of the details of the system. I mean, irrespective of the interaction of the system, we don't have to assume that it's an ideal gas or anything. All we have to assume is it's in equilibrium with some temperature path, T. I mean, here beta is 1 by T. Okay, so this is about equilibrium. Now, I mean, no such general results are available when one goes beyond equilibrium. So now we are in the regime of non-equilibrium. And when any of the conditions of equilibrium is violated, we say that we are in a non-equilibrium regime. And this, if you look around, then actually non-equilibrium is ubiquitous. So from cell movements transport of protein in our body cells, to the wind traits, everything, I mean, most natural phenomena are actually in non-equilibrium. Okay, and no general theoretical formulation is available. So there is no complete picture as something called non-equilibrium thermodynamics. It doesn't exist. So, and because it's so general, one can achieve non-equilibrium in various ways. So one is to drive the system. Okay, as you all of you probably have seen these pictures, where yes, as all of you probably have seen the picture where a conducting rod is connected between two thermal baths. So here the drive is like a temperature gradient. So heat flows from the hotter bath to the colder bath, and then you can also impose a non-equilibrium by adding a non-potential force. So when the force is not derived from a potential, and then one can also get non-equilibrium conditions by having some time-dependent change in the system, and then so in this talk we are going to talk about another specific kind of non-equilibrium systems, which are the so-called active or self-propelled systems. So they are not driven externally as such, but they are self-propelled. Okay. So what is this? What are these active systems? So in general, active matter refers to a collection of self-propelled or active agents. So we will see what these are as we go along. But the remarkable feature about these particles is that the basic feature that they are able to generate directed motion, consuming energy from the environment at an individual level. So each active agent can actually absorb energy from the environment and then it can move on its own. Okay. So that way it's inherently non-equilibrium. So there is no way we can control it and make it equilibrium because they're absorbing energy and just moving on their own. So it's like having an engine of their own. And the examples can be found at all scales actually. So in nature, like bacterial motion. So here there are some representative picture. So this is a bacteria called E. coli. We'll see more about it in a moment. And this is a bird flock. This is a fish school. So these are like natural examples of active matter or active particles in the case of bacteria here, like a single bacterium. And then there are also artificial or man-made active particles, like these Jenner's particles, which are half coated with some chemical, and then Jenner's rods, which are moving because of some sort of shape asymmetry. And then this is a toy called Hex bug, which also shows certain active characteristics. So it turns out that this active matter, they show novel properties at both collective and individual level. And it's the latter that we will be talking about today. But before going there, let's see just how different this active matter are. So this is a video showing how a bird flock is forming and evolving with time. Okay, beautiful patterns are forming. So each of the birds can be thought of as an active agent. Okay, so this is one example in the macroscopic regime. Each bird is like a macroscopic thing. And on the other hand, if we look at a bacterium, so these are the sizes are like 1 micron. So if you look at one particular one here, so what they are doing is that they're moving in a straight line and then suddenly they're changing their direction. These are some from some experiments. So if you follow one, so this is these kind of things are not seen in equilibrium. So clearly they are moving in a certain direction and they are changing direction by, on their own accord. So they have some source of energy and which they are using to move. Okay, so these two are examples from nature. And then there is this so-called Jenner's particle. So if you notice these particles, how they move is that this is some sort of sphere, probably some polymer sphere, and then half of the surface is actually coated with something. Okay, I don't know what exactly they are coated with here, but typically it's coated with carbon or gold. So what happens is that when one shines light on it, so these carbon coated particles are immersed in some medium, sometimes some binary mixture of liquid, and at a certain temperature. So when light is, when one shines light on these particles, so the carbon side, carbon coated side actually absorbs more heat. So this side becomes hotter than the other side. And then the medium around it, around this side also actually undergoes some transformation due to the heat. And that allows the particle to move in that direction. So if you look at it again, so if you follow one of the particles, so it is moving along this black cap direction, okay? And then it is also rotating. So the direction at which this black cap points is not fixed, it's also rotating. Okay? So this is a typical feature of active particles, that the direction of motion evolves sort of stochastically. And as a last example, I'll just show this shape asymmetry. So this is like an L-shaped particle, which is moving in some medium. So this is again, it's a man-made artificial active particle, which shows quite striking feature. So this kind of particles, this Jenner's particles or asymmetric particles, they have actually huge application because this can be used in drug delivery, etc., for targeted transport. Okay. So yeah, as I said, so we saw some examples of active particles, and now I'll just very briefly say what kind of collective behavior they show. Although, I'm not going to discuss much of the collective behavior, just for an idea why active particles are so important. So they show a lot of unique behavior, actually. So first of all, as we saw with the bird flock, it's flocking and swarming. That's one thing we already saw. Then there are also phenomena like motility-induced face separation. So here you see this is a picture from I think some simulation where the red area indicates where the density is high, and the yellow area indicates where the density is low. So you can see that somehow the low density and high density regions are sort of separating. So this is what is called a phase separation. And then there is also pattern formation. So this is again from some simulation with the model of bacteria. So bacterial colony growth happens in such a pattern format. This is quite amazing. And then there are also crystal formation, but which crystal forms and breaks dynamically. So this is from some experiment with those kind of genus particles. And then there is flocking, like bird flock, but with artificial particles now. So these are active rods, and they flock together. And the direction of flocking is decided by the asymmetry in the shape. So these are rod-like particles, so they have a preferred direction to move. Okay. Yes. So this is about collective behavior. Next, what is more surprising is that even at single particle levels, these active particles show very deep behavior. And some of the novel properties which are associated with such particles is that when they are put in a potential, so in an energy landscape, so they don't follow this Gibbs-Boltzmann distribution. Okay, they don't show their energy distribution is not exponential minus beta e. Suppose it's in a potential, and it is not likely to be where the potential is minimum. So that's again very surprising, right? All equilibrium particles or whatever we have seen so far, they always like to be where the energy is minimum. But these active particles, not like that. Okay. So this is again from an experiment. I'll come back to it in more details later. And this is an experiment with a confinement. So what they like also is that typically if you put a collection of active particles, collection has nothing to do with it. I mean, even if it's one particle, so what they like is to be near the boundary of the confinement. So here, if you see, these are a few bacteria. There is no interaction almost. It's very dilute solution, and they like to be near the boundary. Okay, and then there are also certain anomalous dynamical features. So this is a trajectory. So we'll come to that. We'll come to that in some more details. So the question that we are going to ask today is how to understand this single particle behavior theoretically. Okay. So yeah, the objectives of this talk are more clearly. So we are talking about statistical properties of single or non-interacting active particles. And the question we are going to ask is that what are the specific signatures of activity? How are they different quantitatively? We already have some answers qualitatively, but how are they quantitatively different than their passive or equilibrium counterparts? Okay, and the observables that we are hello
yes ma'am, we are listening.
Okay no there was some yes. So the observables we are going to focus on are the mean square displacement, so the typical spread of a particle during a given time, and the position distribution, so the probability for the particle to be at a certain position at some time t. There are other observables as well, but we are not going to go into the complicated things yet. Okay. So what we'll do is that we'll use some theoretical models, the so-called minimal models. So we are trying to write some simple equations, like equations of motion, which would give us the kind of motion that we saw in experiments or the video that we saw. Okay. So this is a kind of microscopic approach. And by nature, these models have to be stochastic. So there has to be some role of noise, because as we saw, each particle moves. There is no determinism in that. We are talking about statistical properties. So there should be certain common features. First of all, as we saw in all these videos, they are showing some kind of directed motion. So we should be able to get out that directed motion from the model we are writing. And then there is some kind of internal orientation along which the particle moves. Okay. So for the two kinds of motion that we saw, there are two famous models. One is the active Brownian particle, the so-called active Brownian particle, which we saw for the genus particles, this carbon or gold capped particles, where the direction in which it moves, that changes slowly but stochastically. The other one is for the bacteria-like motion, which is the so-called run and tumble particles, where the particle moves in a straight line, and then it suddenly changes its direction and moves in a different direction. So I'm going to talk about these two models, the first one in a little bit more detail than the second one. So let's start with this active run and tumble particle. Okay, so here maybe it's a good time to pause. Is there any question so far? Okay, I'm guessing not. So let's start with the active Brownian particle. Okay, so it describes the motion of an overdamped particle. Overdamped meaning there is no acceleration. So the mass of the particle is so small that we can ignore the acceleration term. So the equation of motion will be first order in time derivative. Okay, and it's self-propelling with a constant speed. Let me call it V naught. So we'll, for the sake of simplicity, let's just talk about about two dimension. So the particle and where the particle is given by its position, which is xy. And then there is the internal orientation, which is an angle phi. So here on the right-hand side, there's a sketch. So the blue circle is my particle. And then the velocity vector, this is the internal orientation, which makes an angle phi with the x-axis. Okay, that's how I'm characterizing it. And the motion of this particle is that it moves along this internal orientation with a constant speed V naught, but the but the orientation itself changes with time, changes randomly. Okay, and how that change occurs is encoded here. So this phi dot is given by some random quantity. So this is the so-called random white noise. So we will not go into the mathematical properties of this, but the point is that phi evolves kind of randomly. Okay, so let's have a look at the just to complete. So because it's moving with a constant speed at an angle phi with the x-axis, so the velocity component along x is simply v0 cos phi. Okay, phi evolves with time, that's why I have written phi of t, but x dot is simply v0 cos phi. Similarly, along the y direction, the component is simply v0 sin phi. Okay, so this gives my equation of motion. So three first order coupled equations. These are because of the random nature of the force, these are called Langevin equation. So when you add some random force in the usual Newton's equation, that's typically called Langevin equations. And just to remind you, we have not considered the acceleration term, the x double dot term, because it's an overdamped limit. So the acceleration, the particle is so small that the inertial term can be dropped off. Okay, and then there is one parameter. This is the rotational diffusion constant, which dictates how fast or how slow this phi is going to evolve. Okay, the internal orientation. So let's have a look at how does the trajectory of such a particle evolve. Okay. So let's see. Okay, so I'm fixing some value of tr. Okay, and this is the way the particle is moving. So if you see, it's like moving in a sort of in a certain direction for some time, and then it is changing, and then again it's moving in for a length of time in certain direction. Okay, and if we start it again, okay, let's start from. So if we start it again, then it's again going in a completely different path because the dynamics is completely stochastic. So each time it will go in a different trajectory. And we are asking question on the statistics of it. Okay, so we'll see how the position distribution evolves and how the spread changes with time, etc. Okay, so here from this trajectory picture, I'll just point out two things. One is that, so as I said, I mean, for a certain stretch, it's like moving in a certain direction. So we can say that it has a memory of this angle for this length of time. Okay, so that's like a time scale. And it turns out that time scale is exactly given by the inverse of the diffusion constant. So that is the actually only time scale in the system. So where were we? Yeah. Yes. So at this point, It's good to just take a quick review of the ordinary Brownian particle. So I'm calling this dynamics as active Brownian particle. So let's do a brief recap of what happens when it's not active, when it's passive or just usual Brownian particle. So the Brownian motion, again, all of you are familiar with probably. So it was first observed by Robert Brown, and then a comprehensive theory was given by Einstein. So in mathematical terms, the equations of motion is, again, I'm talking about overdamped Brownian motion. So the equation of motion is just x dot equal to some random force. Y dot is some random force. This random force is coming from the medium. Okay. And in this case, there is no orientation. The particle is not moving in any given direction. It's just moving randomly. Okay. Again, let's have a quick look at how it evolves and how it's different from okay, so it's just moving randomly. There's no directedness in the motion. Okay, so it's kind of clear already how the trajectories are different. So here also, if we start again, it will go it will follow a different trajectory, but all of these trajectories are very different than the active ones. So this kind of trajectories probably all of you have seen while studying Brownian motion. So the features that characterize such Brownian motion is that, first of all, the mean square displacement, both along x and y, and if it is in higher dimension along each direction, it's actually increasing linearly with time. So this is what is called diffusive motion. Okay, and then the position distribution at any time is given by a Gaussian. So in 2D, it's simply exponential of minus x square plus y square divided by t. T is, mean square displacement is also the width of the distribution, which grows with time. But at all times, it remains true that the probability to be at the origin where it starts, so I'm assuming that it starts from x equal to y equal to zero, the probability to be there remains the maximum. So it's a Gaussian with a peak at the origin. It flattens as the time increases, but the origin becomes most probable at all times, except at infinity when it completely flattens. Okay. So So now we are going to come back to the question that what are the signatures of activity? How can we quantify them for an active Brownian particle? So as you already saw that for this ABP motion, active Brownian particle motion, there is some sort of a memory in the orientation, and there is a time scale associated with that. Okay, it's given by 1 by dr. So smaller the dr, the orientation is remembered for longer time. And it turns out that when one is looking at motions at time shorter than this time scale, then one can see very strong signatures of activity. At later times also one can see, but that takes more effort. Signatures of activity are most easily visible in free space at short time. Okay. So what are those signatures? First of all, the motion is non-diffusive. If we look at the mean square displacement, it does not grow as t. Okay. One can calculate it exactly. I'm not showing you the expressions, but it does not grow as t. And the distribution is also also very non-Gaussian. So this is already very different from usual Brownian motion. And then there's another feature is that there is an anisotropy. So the distribution, the marginal distributions along the initial orientation and its orthogonal direction. So earlier we were starting from phi equal to zero. So it means if we look at the position distribution along x-axis and y-axis, those are very different. We'll see it in a moment, how they look. So these are clear signatures of activity. Because of the active nature of the motion, this non-equilibrium features come into play. So and then at late times, it crosses over to a typically diffusive behavior. We'll also see what I mean by that. But there are certain hidden signatures of activity even then. But we are not going to see those. Okay, so let's just look at the mean square displacement. As I said, it can be calculated explicitly. And at short time, particularly, if one looks at it, So yeah, I'm looking at the x square minus x square average minus x average square, which is actually technically a little bit different than mean square displacement, but it has similar behavior. Okay, so as I said, I mean, it's an isotropic. So the mean square displacement along x and y at short times are very different. So you can see it from this plot. Okay. So this purple curve is sigma x square, green curve is sigma y square. So they grow differently. One grows as t to the power 4, the other one grows as t cube. So both non-diffusive and very anisotropic. Okay. And then at late times, both of them sort of converge to a linear growth. So this is what I meant by a typically diffusive behavior at late times. Late times being when time is much, much larger than the arrangements. So if we actually go back to this trajectory picture we were having. So let's clear and start with the large rotational diffusion constant. Okay, so that we can quickly see. Yeah. So when rotational diffusion constant is very large, then the time scale is also small. Okay, then we should be able to see the effective diffusive nature quickly. And I mean, if it's long enough, then you can see that it's kind of resembling the trajectory here. Okay. At late times, it's not possible to distinguish so easily. Okay, and then there's an effective diffusion constant, which is given by this expression. Okay. So what we are seeing is that there is some sort of a dynamical crossover from a very non-diffusive behavior to an equilibrium-like behavior as time is increased. So this feature is actually very generic for all kinds of active particles. So at short times, they show strong signatures of activity. Those signatures might be different depending on the model, but at late times, they sort of go over to a typically diffusive behavior. Okay. We'll also see that for RTP in a moment. Now, how much time do I have? Okay. Yeah. So now let's look at the position distribution. Okay, in this short time period. So this is a plot obtained from a numerical simulation. So the particle starts from the origin, and we are measuring the distribution at some time t equal to 1, and my dr value is 0.1. So the time is much smaller than dr inverse, which is 10. And this is sickle shaped plot is a distribution. So I don't know how well you can see it. So the dark blue indicates the region which is most likely. I mean, the probability is highest. So okay. So the anisotropy is clear from this plot, and we can also sort of understand it qualitatively. So what happens is that the particle starts from the origin. We are taking phi equal to 0 at time t equal to 0. And we said that the particle sort of remembers the initial orientation for a time of the order of dr inverse. So the particle simply goes along this x-axis. And after the time dr inverse, it starts to diffuse in other directions. Okay. So that's why that's how this shape is coming about. If we had started from a different initial orientation, then this whole thing will be rotated. Okay. Again, this is a feature at short times only. So if we now look at the distribution of x and y coordinates separately, so what we see is that along x, so this is plotted as v0 t minus x. So we are seeing a peak near to 0, which means that the actual peak is actually near this v0 t. Which is the maximum distance. So if you remember the dynamics, because it's cos phi, it can never be larger than 1. So the maximum distance that the particle can cover at time t is actually v0 t. And that is what happens at short times. So along x, it almost stays close to that distance. There's a high peak there. Again, it's very different than passive particles equilibrium kind of dynamics. In equilibrium, we saw that doesn't matter how long we wait at short times and also at long times, the particle remains to be found most likely at the origin where it starts from. Here, it's not that. It's starting from here And after a short time, it's almost impossible to find it in the origin. So these distributions can also be computed exactly. These are compared with numerical simulations. Here, I'll not show the expressions. They're fairly complicated. But the general idea is that it's highly skewed. And for x, the peak is near visibility. On the other hand, if we look here along y, the distribution is kind of symmetric, right? So this is what is shown here. This is actually a Gaussian distribution, although it's not a diffusive one. The width of the distribution does not grow as t, but rather as t cube. Okay. So this, yes. Okay. So this is one of the remarkable features, and we'll again see that this qualitative features are same for all kind of active particles. So at short times, they prefer to be away from the initial point, and then there's some anisotropy depending on the initial orientation. Okay, now the next question, because we started with the Gibbs-Boltzmann distribution in equilibrium. So the next question one can ask is that what happens when these kind of particles are put in an external potential? Okay, so there have been many experiments done on that. Here I'm showing some pictures from such an experiment where an ABP-like particle, a Jenner's particle, was put in a harmonic-like trap, and the position distribution was measured. Okay, so this is the distance from the origin, the radial distance, and y-axis shows the distribution. Okay, and what they found is that depending on the trap strength, how large or small it is than dr, there are the stationary distribution. It has very different shapes depending on the kind of confinement we are talking about. So when the confinement is weak, meaning that the strength of the harmonic trap is much smaller than the rotational diffusion constant, then we actually get a Gaussian like Boltzmann like distribution. Okay, so this is like a Gaussian distribution. It's like because the potential is not exactly harmonic, it's also harmonic like. What they achieved in the experiment. If we were having an exact harmonic potential, then this would be a Boltzmann distribution. Yeah, the limiting case. Okay, so this is not the surprising result. The surprising result happens in the other limiting scenario when the confinement is very strong. So dr is much, much smaller than the trap strength. In that case, what happens is that the particle actually likes to be near the boundary of the potential. So, for a harmonic potential, there is no boundary as such, but given the harmonic potential strength and V0, there is a length scale. That's the maximum distance that the particle can travel. And that's what I'm referring as the boundary. So what happens is that the particles like to be near that boundary. So the peak is near that boundary. Okay. And this is what this is happening in a strong confinement region. So it's like a phase transition, quote unquote phase. It's not really a macroscopic phase, but the shape of the position distribution actually changes when one changes the trap strength. Okay, this is again a very unique feature of active particles. In equilibrium, we don't see that. Okay, and one more thing. So here, the distribution that we are talking about is a stationary distribution. So this density profile of the distribution, it doesn't change with time. But it's not equilibrium. It's stationary, but it is not equilibrium. Okay. We'll just see how to theoretically understand this kind of experimental results. So in that case, one can again write the Langevin equations, and we have to add the force from the harmonic potential. Okay. So in x dot we add this minus mu x, y dot we add minus mu y, and the rest are exactly same. Okay. So just a quick reminder, as I was already telling you. So for passive Brownian particles in this scenario, if a passive Brownian particle is put in a harmonic potential, then the stationary distribution, which is also equilibrium there, it will be Gaussian. Actually, it is Gaussian at all times, but particularly in the stationary state, it's Gaussian, which is consistent with the Gibbs-Boltzmann distribution. So it will be simply exponential minus beta uxy. Uxy is my two-dimensional potential. Okay. So now again, I will not show you the calculations. These are results from simulations. So with this theoretical model, if we go on to compute the stationary distribution, we see the same kind of shape transition that was seen in the experiment. Okay. So when in the strongly active limit, So when dr is much, much smaller than mu, what happens is that so this is a plot of, 3D plot of the stationary distribution. So the pink color indicates where the probability is highest. So it's also, 3D, so you can see. So white means that probability is close to zero. So there is almost no chance for the particle to be near the minimum of the potential. So that is very surprising, right? We are seeing this kind of surprises in the active particle. We have seen that at short times, they like to stay away from the origin, but then there was no energy. It was completely in free space. Now, it turns out that they also don't care if there's an attractive force towards the origin. There is a regime where they actually manage to evade that force and stay near the boundary. Okay, and the other limit is the passive limit. When the trap is weak, dr is much larger than mu. And in that case, we see an equilibrium-like distribution. It's like a single Gaussian peak at the origin. Okay, so this is more or less what I had to say about active Brownian particles. So what we saw is that they show very different behavior than, I'm repeating it again and again, very different behavior than passive Brownian motion, which all of you are familiar with. And this holds true for the motion in free space, as well as the motion in the presence of an external potential. So here, of course, I'm talking about harmonic potential because that is the simplest to handle mathematically. But even in any other kinds of nonlinear force scenario, if there's the potential which is strong enough, if there's a bound state, then this statement remains true that there is always an active regime where the particle likes to be away from the potential minimum and at a certain distance from the minimum. And then there is another regime one can achieve by changing the parameters of the system where it looks more or less like a passive particle. Okay, so if we are measuring this distribution only and looking at more or less qualitatively and typical fluctuations, we will not be able to distinguish it from a passive particle with an effective diffusion constant or an effective temperature. Whereas here, just by simply looking at the shape, we know that this is an active, or there is some activity in the system. Okay, and now I will quickly go to this other model that I mentioned earlier, the bacterial motion one. But again, here, maybe I'll pause for a few seconds and if there's any question. Okay. Okay, that probably means it's not clear at all. So let's finish. So let's talk about this run and tumble particle. So we saw in some video that the bacteria move very differently than these genus particles, right? So how they move is that they, here is a diagram showing. So there is some internal mechanism that this is again for E. coli. There are some flagella which move in a certain way. So we are not bothered about the internal mechanism, but the motion, effective motion is that they move almost in a straight line for a certain distance. And then they suddenly change the direction by a finite amount. Not like changing the direction all the time slowly. They don't change along this run mode. So this is why it's called run and tumble. There's a run mode where it runs on a straight line with a constant velocity, and then it tumbles. And by tumbling, it changes the direction of the motion. And in the for the previous plot, there's a question. So for the previous plot, what exactly does the color code mean? The intensity of the color implies the probability, but why are there two different colors? Okay. So this is like a heat map. Okay. So it's like a continuous spectrum starting from zero. White means zero, and then to pink, which has a certain value, maybe close to four, and then it's a continuous spectrum. Okay. So it's also clear from the height. But if you are putting, are you familiar with heat maps? Where you can see on a two-dimensional plot, like contour plots also, on a two-dimensional plot with the color code. Okay. Right. So, coming back to the RTP. So they have this run and tumble kind of motions as we saw in the experiments with bacteria. So how do we model it? Okay. So again, we go for a very simple model. So we write the Langevin equations as before. So x dot is V0 cos theta t, y dot is V0 sin theta t. But now theta does not evolve by rotational diffusion, but theta changes by jump. Okay, so theta can go to some theta prime with some rate gamma, and that theta prime can be anything. So here from this picture, you can see that theta prime can be anything. Okay, so let's see how those how the trajectory of these things look. Okay, so this is going in a straight line, and then this red arrow, which is the direction that changes, and it starts to go in a different direction. Okay, and how long it will continue in a certain direction depends on the tumbling rate. Okay, so if the tumbling rate is much smaller, so you'll see that it will continue in a given direction for longer. Again, typically, these are all statistical statements. There would be certain trajectories where some jumps have occurred shorter, but the typical lengths will be much longer, as you can see here. Okay, and here then the role of the time scale is played by the inverse of the of this tumbling rate. Okay, and so qualitatively, the behavior of these run and tumble particles are very similar to active run and particles, although there are certain quantitative differences. So as I already said, there are strong signatures of activity at short times, and the short times here is the time scale is gamma inverse, and here again particles stay away from the origin. So if you look at this plot, this shows the distribution along x-axis, so the x component of the position, at different times for a fixed gamma. So at short times, like for example, if you see this orange plots, so here there is a peak at the boundaries. Okay, so the particle is most likely to be here. If you go at not the orange one. First, the smallest time is this gray one, this one, where it's the probability to be near the origin is very low. It's much higher at the boundaries, and then as time evolves, so what happens is that the probability to be at the boundary near T starts to decrease, and at the origin it starts to increase. And this is how at late times we get the Gaussian-like distribution. Okay, when time is much, much smaller than gamma inverse, this is what we get. So this one. And again, if we look at the stationary distribution in the presence of a harmonic potential or any external potential, harmonic is the simplest one, then we see two very different kind of shapes as one changes this relative strength of the tumbling rate and the trap strength. Okay, in one case, it's so this black one is kind of like a passive particle, not quite there yet, but if we increase the gamma much more, it will become like a Gaussian one, but it is still more likely to be at the origin. On the other hand, in a very active regime, when gamma is smaller than the trap strength, which I think is one here, then it has this convex shape. So once again, there is a kind of a shape transition in the position distribution of an active particle in an external potential. Okay. So yeah, so I'll stop here and I'll quickly summarize the things that we discussed. First of all, I mean, we talked about active matter, which is a special kind of non-equilibrium system in the sense that they are self-propelled. This there's no external drive, there's no global drive. Each agent to its own, it moves stochastically, but giving rise to a directed motion. And this whole self-propulsion actually leads to many unique statistical behavior, which are never seen in equilibrium. Actually, most of them cannot be seen in equilibrium. And this unusual behavior extends to even single particle or non-interacting particle cases. And in free space, if one looks at these active particles, the motion of these active particles, then there are certain signatures of activity which are most easily seen at short times. I'm coming to the question. Just one second. Let me finish. And then there are sometimes there are anisotropies in the distribution. And then when one looks at the stationary state in the presence of an external force or external potential, then it is possible to have a stationary distribution where the particles are actually not at the minimum of the potential, but rather close to the maximum. For harmonic potential, there is no maximum, it just goes to infinity, but away from the minimum. And I just want to mention that this behavior of active matters is still, far from well understood. It's an active area of research still. There are various kinds of studies being done at individual particle level, at collective, to understand the collective behavior. There are many kinds of experiments which are being done. There are also many fantastic tabletop experiments which are being done. Like this hex bug that I showed you, it's you can buy it from Amazon, and there are experiments done with these hex bugs which show which also agrees with the theoretical results pretty well, and which shows all these features of active particles. So Shoyam is asking, is the phase transition here in RTP due to discrete rotational symmetry breaking, or is it something else? No, the phase transition, by phase transition you mean the shape transition, right? So we saw that it's not a phase transition in the sense of symmetry breaking, because it's not a macroscopic system. Okay, so in the thermodynamic sense, one cannot have a phase transition for a single particle. One needs to, the symmetry breaking that you were talking about, one needs to go to the thermodynamic limit, number of constraints going to infinity. Here it's, that's why I said quote unquote phase, it's more like a shape transition, and that is happening for both RTP and ABP, right? In ABP, it's not a discrete jump. It's the orientation changes continuously, and both these things actually show the same kind of shape transition. And if you, qualitatively, it's easy to understand, right? So let's see how it can happen. So suppose the particle starts with a certain orientation, okay, and the orientation is changing very slowly. That parameter is, let's say, dr or gamma or something. So the that is very small. So what the particle does is that it just moves on a straight line. It goes as far as it can go. After a certain point, it cannot go any further because the force becomes too large. Okay, so that determines the boundary where it is going to spend most of the time. So what the particle does? So at this position, the force, if the particle cannot escape, but what it can do is that it can now rotate. It has time to now change the orientation. So basically, if you look at the trajectory in TRAP that I did not show, but it goes straight, and more or less hits the boundary, and then it changes the direction, and then it starts to populate near the boundary. You get the rotational symmetry back. But because of this memory, it just goes straight and hits the boundary. On the other hand, if this memory parameter is much smaller, the time scale is much smaller, which means that that the orientation starts to change much before the boundary is hit. Okay, so the memory is forgotten immediately. So in that case, the particle stays close to where it started from, near the minimum of the potential. In that case, again, because the memory is quickly forgotten, it's like a passive particle. This memory is what makes it active. So when it's quickly forgotten, then the behavior of a passive particle in TRAP takes over, and we get an equilibrium-like shape. Okay, is it clear?
Any other question from participants, please write in the chat box.
So Joyashi is asking, we know for active particles, the moment has a transition from T cube, T four, T square to T. But if we include drag force of solvent in Langevin equation, we get moment to be this. That means we'll get T square to transition here at 12. Actually, I don't understand. Joyashi, can you speak and say what is the question?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, for the active particles, we get the transition of Tisca to T, or I mean, for T higher than one to T transition for the moments. But for normal Brownian
particles, it's not a transition. It's a crossover, by the way.
I mean, it's a crossover. But if we take normal Brownian particles, if we consider the drag force like minus six pi eta R V in the Langevin's equation. With this 6 pi eta rv and the white noise, if we consider both, then we get the moment as something like 2 kt by m gamma t minus something e to the power minus gamma t. And these terms, for short time, it is proportional to t square, and for long time, it is proportional to t.
Right.
We get the t square to t in normal Brownian case also. So what is the difference?
Yes. So the difference is that the equation that you mentioned, that's not in the overdamped limit. Okay. So when we are writing this equation for normal Brownian motion here, so we are actually including the drag force. Otherwise, how am I getting the x dot term? That is exactly it. So the diffusion constant actually depends on this 6 pi eta, right? So this is in the overdamped limit. On the other hand, if you are in the inertial limit, so the particle, the mass of the particle is so high that you cannot ignore the x double dot term, then it is true that then if we look at the position moment, then we get this t square to t transition. But then one has to compare with the inertial active particle as well. There you get something else. So it's not okay to compare an inertial Brownian particle with an overdamped active Brownian particle or RTP.
Okay, then. Thank you.
Any other question? So I think no other question is there. So I request Dr. Upendranath Nandi for formal vote of thanks.
I'll stop sharing.
So let me thank first today's speaker, Dr. Runa Basu, for her beautiful presentation of this today's lecture, Physics of Active Particles, say Beyond Equilibrium. She has started from very basics of thermodynamics, and then some basic facts occurring in nature, what you observe in real life. And that is translated into physics using the standard laws, assuming the equilibrium as well as some non-equilibrium part. And we are thankful to the college authority for providing us this Zoom platform to conduct this webinar. Let me thank our principal ma'am, Dr. Madhu Manjiri Mandal, for this, our vice principal sir, Dr. Supratim Das, and also the IQAC coordinator, Dr. Swamnath Bhattacharjee, for this, helping us to conduct this seminar together with IQAC and the Department of Physics. I congratulate head of the department, Dr. Joita Chaudhary, for connecting our students and today's speaker, other colleagues, my dear students, for their support and cooperation for this successful webinar. At last, I again thank our students, our brilliant students, Dr. Runa Basu. We are really proud of her for this beautiful presentation in this webinar. Thank you all.
Thank you, Una.
Thank you so much. Okay, should I stay around if there are some other questions or should?
Oh, okay. Is there any other question?
Are you in the lab, Jyoti? Can you?
Yes. I'm in the lab.
Which? It's a control lab. Okay. Yeah, it has been long. Yes. So So now the college is open.
Yes, it is open now.
Okay.
From Tuesday onward.
এখন সব ক্লাস তাহলে মানে ইন পারসন
না না
না
ও আচ্ছা আচ্ছা মানে যারা করতে